Morten, of course, already spoke this morning. Can you pronounce it breqn?
Yeah, I think that was what Michael intended, but I know Barbara would probably be the one to know.
What was the question?
How do you pronounce it? Breqn?
Breqn.
Really?
Yeah.
So the breqn package revised and revived it.
Yeah.
This is going to be a traditional comedy act with me.
Okay, I'll have to grow shorter. Yeah, as the title says, this is about the breqn package, revised and revived. I don't know if any of you have heard about it before, but I'll start with a bit of history. This was a package begun by Michael Downs of the AMS. I'm sure you've all heard of him in some way. He presented it at the TUC conference 10 years ago, I believe. Some of you may even have seen that presentation. Sadly, Michael passed away in 2003, and the project has been abandoned since then. Although there are many people interested in what it does, amongst others, people such as Bruce Miller of the NIST, people using it for computer algebra system. Okay, yeah. The original goals of the package was to fix various deficiencies of tech. Anyone who's tried to do left-right scaling of parentheses or similar will know that these box the constants, and it's not to be unboxed. You can only break after relation symbols and after operators, binary operators. You cannot break before. Alignments freeze glue in the math expression. That means that an equation that would have fit when typeset on a regular line will not necessarily fit if you do it in, say, the align environment of AMS math. Another problem is that you often find yourself cluttering the input with markup instructions. And in this day and age, where everything is supposed to be, anything that's math related is supposed to be content MathML or presentation MathML, doing manual markup instructions is not the right way to go. And the most ambitious of the original goals was to do automatic line breaking, because we can have automatic line breaking for regular text. The author does not have to know how to break text into lines. And just because the author is a mathematician doesn't mean that the author is also a typographer knowing how to break math into lines. So, classic example, if I remember correctly, this is a Taylor polynomial. And as we can see, it was just too wide to fit on one line, so I had to split it up in two lines. Okay, how do I do that? Well, this is quite a beauty, but this is about the best you can do in regular LaTeX using AMS math. Have an equation, you split it over several lines, you mark up the, you use the ampersands to mark up the relation symbols where it should align, and then you just hope for the best. And what about using breqn? Okay, use the equivalent of the equation environment called DMath, and you do nothing. And the result is what you see below. This has been typeset by the new improved version working with Beamer. And then there's another example using only 75% of the same line width. Has to be broken in a slightly different way. The last two binary operators have been moved to the new line and indented. And then we can try the last one, typeset at 50% of the line width using regular LaTeX. Again, we add even more manual markup just to get it into the right shape. And the breqn, typesetting the same thing, do nothing. But before breqn knows how to actually break equations into lines, it has to investigate. It has to choose a layout, you see. Like, I saw the Word 2007 incorporates an automatic line breaking algorithm. And the algorithm is such that each line after the first is indented by some fixed amount. And that's it. Breqn is slightly smarter, as it knows there are several kinds of symbols. This example, you can see the relation symbols have been aligned on top of each other. Binary operators are pushed in just a bit. You also have drop letters when the left-hand side is very, very large, so that it won't fit. You can have skew letters when the left-hand side and the first right-hand side might fit, but the rest won't. You also have some examples where you use the algorithm, but you wind up with a large chunk of white space. And if you want to save the Swedish rainforest or whatever, you don't want that. So sometimes it's better to choose a slightly different layout. Hereby you actually save several lines of output. This is exactly the same as before, except the first right-hand sign is missing one bit, and now it fits on one line, so we can choose a different kind of layout. So, and again, we wind up saving a couple of lines. So, the big problem is that unlike regular text, as I talked about earlier, regular text is spilled into galleys, they have a predefined shape, and it doesn't matter if you're writing a letter to your auntie or you're writing a grocery list, whatever, or in which language you write it, you fill it into a predefined shape. But for math, it's the other way around. You need to know what you're writing before you can find the right shape to fill it into. So we have to coerce the various symbols to tell us what is actually going on. We also have to do many other things, like these left to right boxes, make sure they get unwrapped somehow. We have to augment certain characters, certain symbols with things lacking in the engine, like what's the penalty for breaking before relation? Because tech was written as if Don decided to not do any attempt at automatic line breaking in display math. He only added support for inline math, which is why he had post-break penalties. And you have to do all sorts of space adjustments for binary operators and such. So, the easiest and dirtiest way to do this, if it has to be usable by ordinary human beings, is to make each and every math symbol an active character. But it's not super active, it's only local active in math mode. Tech has a math mode active trick. Where you can set the math code of a character to hexadecimal 8000, and then it becomes active, but only in math mode. However, this causes problems, and I honestly believe that Michael did not speak French. Because if he had, he would have typeset stuff in French. And French Babel also needs to make certain symbols active, such as the colon and semicolon and exclamation mark. And this is where the real problem is. This is the big problem of breqn as it is now, is that It wants to do, it wants some characters to be active. Like, you want the letter A to be a macro, but only in math mode. So this opens up a can of worms. We have macros that need to be active in some context, but they don't have to do anything in other contexts. The colon needs to, when we're processing French text, needs to do the text French colon that inserts a small space before itself, but only in text mode, whereas in math mode it has to do something completely different. And this is what I call multi-mode commands. There are many other examples of it, like writing to bookmarks in PDF files. Anyone who's tried to do a math heading and processing it with hyperref will know that you always have to know the macro, tech, or PDF. And this is a big problem. There are many other contexts where you have these commands that have to do completely different things. This is something I hope LaTeX will remember. And as I say, this part needs to be reworked. I have some ideas, but it would be best to fix this on the engine level of things. It's not fun to have to redo all of Babel active support, or to do breqn active characters through the Babel system, because that is going to be so inefficient. It's going to be criminally inefficient. Okay. What breqn does is it basically typesets the display as a series of boxes. Every time it sees a relation symbol, it does a forced break, typesets a line of text, sees another relation symbol, or again, typesets it as running text, and then it simply unwinds this box. Wraps each piece as it goes by, and then winds up with a list of boxes containing all the smallest fragments of the equation. Then it does a trial typesetting in each step of the algorithm, checks if it looks okay. Of course, it starts with the most common types first, like 90% of equations in a textbook will fit on one line, so it's reasonable to start with that. But there are many, many other possibilities, as you saw earlier. Several different layout types. And then there are, of course, all those layouts that where it just doesn't fit because there's something much too wide. Very large fractions and such. The short-term goals is to transform the sources into something readable. Barbara was so kind to hand me the original sources of breqn, but unfortunately Michael used a homegrown coding system using control characters and whatnot, which is very interesting, and there are certainly some good ideas, but unfortunately it's completely unreadable unless you're Michael. And I'm not. So that's one thing. The other thing is that actually it doesn't work with Beamer or with Peter's excellent memoir class. Simply because some things were not anticipated. Like what you can delay to the infamous at begin document arms race. And this is one case where breqn is just too late. No matter what is done. So, this version will not require anything more than the current version does. It will be able to run on the EMS production system and will not require any ETEC extensions and such. Just try to patch it up as good as possible. And most importantly, we'll put it on CTAN using Jim's excellent uploading system. With the LaTeX project license. The medium term goal is what I hope to do in my studies. I was able to write a bachelor thesis on breqn just to get a grasp of what it does and how it abuses tech. The reality, the first, when it grabs the boxes, tech is much too good for it, because tech does its total fit algorithm for the line breaking. But in reality, we'd want a much, much simpler line breaking algorithm, namely one that just does, whenever I say line break, then do a line break. So one has to force tech into doing that, which is not as easy as one would hope. But it can be done, more or less. There are some weak points in the algorithm. How big is the left-hand side before it's too big? Well, that depends. Sometimes you can express it as a percentage of the total available line width, but for other layouts, maybe it's a fixed width. And this is something the algorithm currently does not use. It seems like Michael was a little unsure on how to handle it himself, because he says something in one thing in the documentation, but the code is different. So this is a tricky area. The left-hand side in general is a tricky area, because like for one book I was typesetting last week, I had a left-hand side that did not fit on one line. Breqn didn't know what to do with it. It also has problems with when you use automatic scaling of if you use left-right parentheses on the left-hand side. So the morale of this story is you should keep the left-hand side short. And then finding a decent way to support Babel and all these others with active characters is something has to be sorted out, and it has to be sorted out fairly soon, because I mean it's simply not, it just doesn't work, and this is something that has to be done. While porting the code, since I have to port the original code anyway, what I've also done as part of the thesis project was to do a version in LaTeX 3 form, or as I say, pseudo LaTeX 3 form, because some of the functionality is simply in the LaTeX 3 kernel is simply not there yet. It has to be done first. Tries to modularize the code a lot more than Michael did. He did quite a bit of that, but there are still some areas where it could be done. Also for other applications, like if you have all these computer algebra systems that tend to spit out fractions and square roots that are 3 feet long. Sometimes you would like to split the contents of these square roots over several lines. This is something that should go into the algorithm, something that could be one of the fallback mechanisms. If something doesn't fit, then at least you can try to split the contents of, say, a fraction or a square root over several lines. And as I talked about before lunch, this will use the paragraph shaping tools of the Galley package, because that's another current problem. Michael tried to do as much as possible within the current LaTeX framework. Whenever you see something that's a different paragraph shape, when fingers crossed and hope for the best. Just hope it's just a regular list and not something more advanced. If breqn meets an initial, then all hell breaks loose. And the last thing, there are many, many things I'd like to add. One very useful thing for natural input is currently provided by the package called NATH. Some of you may know it. It does automatic scaling of fences. So you don't have to remember to put in all those left-right pairs. And since we're already making all characters active, all characters are macros, we might as well just add that extra feature to it. Other long-term goals that I have not listed here are, maybe it's possible, since all characters are Mac Pros, you could, in theory, make it write MathML directly. Every character knows what it is, so you could just ask it to write what it is. That's one possibility. I expect a release during September, and hopefully that will be that'll be a good thing. We hope we can move breqn out of the beta stage and into a 1.0 version. So yeah, that's about it. Asking if there is any way to do a manual override of breqn, and there is. Fortunately, so breqn uses the usual trick of magic penalties. And since it's penalty driven, you can insert penalties by yourself. Like if you want to hide certain relation symbols. If you notice something, if you're writing an equation you know has four relation symbols, but the first two are very, very short, just aliases, then maybe you would like to keep them together and just focus on what's really important if it has to be split over several lines. And then you can insert manual override for hiding these symbols from it. Yes? Certainly keep that in mind. Free flowing is a very important feature, especially for people who are disabled, visually impaired. And the advantage of breqn in this respect is that the main problem of reflowing text done with PDF like tech is that PDF tech uses the glue model, and the glue is just the algorithm Adobe Reader uses for reflowing is one that does not look at, it only recognizes ordinary word spaces. But since tech does not use word spaces but glue, this algorithm breaks. I don't know if it has been fixed in the meantime, but probably not. It is somewhat difficult, but it's certainly a worthwhile goal. The advantage of breqn is, of course, that it works in math mode, so there is no glue per se, the same way as there is in text mode. So that's certainly something I'll keep in mind. Yes.
Do you think of the fallback mechanism if, say, the square root is way too big and there is nothing else to replace by only one half or so, which is typically a tutorial task that is done daily?
Yeah, that's one of the things I would like to extend. That's one, like these radicals or fractions that don't fit. These are typical examples of where you would like to do something else. Like one example was to split them over several lines, but another, as you say, is just use for...
Some others accept exactly what you already proposed, but others don't want to see that.
Yeah, and this would have to be something that could be adjusted depending on your needs. And some would rather say that, well, just have to do it completely different then, and then just let it stick out into the margin and provide your wonderful HBox message. Other questions?
I believe this is the Russian style where you have through the continuation, you have both the end and the beginning with the matching.
Yeah. The Russian, I don't know if everybody are familiar with the Russian style. They love to repeat themselves. Or rather, they love to repeat relation symbols and binary operators. They're repeated at the end of the line and at the beginning of the line, when the break is chosen. And this is somewhat difficult in tech, because tech has this discretionary command that supports pre-break text and post-break text, but unfortunately, it has some. It doesn't work quite as well in math mode, because I believe it's the post-break text that has to be. The pre-break text has to be empty. One of them has to be empty. I forget which one it is. I'm sure Hans knows. No. And this makes it not so easy to do for these. So one has to do another penalty round of making all these relation symbols and binary operators insert special penalties, except this time they have to be different, and you have to have an array of these penalties. And it's not on the top of the list. It's on the to-do list, but it's not on the top, because it's very hard, and it's probably something I would rather delegate to the engine. Of course, the big goal of the package is to make the algorithm foolproof enough so that we have a clear specification we can just write into LaTeX. Because doing it all by macros is, well, it's very inefficient. It works, and it still saves time relative to all the manual markup the author would have to do, but it is very inefficient. Could increase the speed by ten. We could increase it tenfold if we had it added to the engine. So.
You're testing with your equation numbers on both the left and the right, I assume.
Yeah, well, all possible variations. Yeah. Barbara asked if I was testing the equation numbers on both the left and the right hand side of the. Of the equations, and yes, we're testing all possibilities. And as I said, for the LaTeX 3 kernel code, this is also something I'm using in production, because it has a tendency to reveal things you never thought of, like a left-hand side that doesn't fit on one line. And authors have interesting demands sometimes, where they want things. Way they want things to look. So yes, we're testing all possibilities, which of course makes it a lot more complicated, because sometimes the equation number makes it so that you have to choose a different layout, but then if the equation number is there, then it gets confused.